how we're going to talk about holistic application review, I'm going to tell you up front that there's been a lot of talk about holistic application review. We think that it's an important part and probably a necessary part to increase diversity in residency programs, but it's insufficient level. So a lot of people are putting a lot of work, they're putting a lot of work in doing, and they should, and we should, however, it's not enough. And we're going to go over some of the what this review is. Talk about some of the studies that we've been done more related to women's events and more related to graduate medical education. We're going to talk about how to get biased some of these. We're putting in the context of this is part of the whole strategy of increasing diversity in the residency program. I like that idea of not breaking out since we have a more intimate group, but I want to find out a little bit from all of you. What are some of the things that you have struggled with in the application review process, meaning what are the list of your application review? What are some things that you kind of put barriers that kind of hit in doing this?
Last
will not be talking about today in terms of that. The examples are diversity my department? What is the mission of my institution? And what do people, what can they bring to that mission? So this is here with that kind of market. But at that time, we have a dedication to addressing health care disparities. And once we can see that, we give people that and become kind of an information. Another one of the dedication of our mission is to have providers positions that represent our community. And once that is stated, that's one of the goals that we have. So we're coming here. See how if your mission being inoculated is not as labeled to diversity, then it's going to be a really hard thing to do. So that's something that can be done.
Made comments, you know, like, for example, our
that's the principle that I'm saying always wanted to have the stakeholder to get my ready to certainly talk about it. Then I have to maybe just think of that that's a very good. But I think it's a discussion to have. I think it's great to have the top part of the see on the right, because of this new cloud, we're talking about 10 points, they have identified almost 140 more applicants, applicants underrepresented, and they were about a third of them they got the computer. So you can see how that increase by changing that step score by 10 points, going about 10 points, you increase the diversity of data. You can take a look at some of the other things with the experience and attributes, and look specifically at the experiences and attributes, such as Spanish. Do they represent Houston's diverse population? Experiences related to internal service leadership roles. Then they looked at other parts too, so what did they look for metrics? Yes, they used some of these set scores, but they also used more, was there any more academic performance or any troubling letter recommendations? So this is not one of the emergency methods, this comes from my own program. Here. And what we did after applying holistic review and it's a whole strategy, but this paper, if you want to look at it, talks about our diversity in the second book, other things as well, too, that went into increasing diversity of our seed program. And it really is a snowball effect. This, in fact, and to the point of we are even more diverse now, this is different. But take a look at the pace on some of this. We're talking about 1990s, 2000s. This has taken over a decade. This has taken 15 years. And so part of this is patience, part of this being persistent and having perseverance with the process and having people interested in this as well. So this is not something that happens. You see from the East, they have really great results in there. It took a lot of time to get to where we are now. We are very proud of it, but this is not something that happened.
I also think we should be proud of the fact that there are institutions and
holistic review, though I have to say that this has changed a little bit too. And the point of this is we're tweaking it all the time. It's okay to keep your holistic review as you're going through, as you're going through the process. So you see the experiences, attributes, methods, and competencies. The review, EA, CM, the LAC holistic review. We're looking for not only service and leadership, but those that have that directly relate to disadvantaged. We're looking for scholarship and research related to our mission as well. So those are kind of the big things that we push up, as well as some of the actions that you see here. We don't look at what's different from the paper, for example, before we used to screen with the person we make sure that they pass it or not. We actually interviewed from applicants who have failed at step one. And they have become residents, they've changed our administrative system. They're quite amazing to talk a little more about what's in the step score and what that really predicts. Yeah. But now at this point, we really don't have to use any step score. And in terms of looking at the competencies, we're looking at narratives. We're looking for some of the characters to redefine within those narratives. Gender dysphoria. I applaud their work. So they came out with this last year. They took a look at their scoring rubric, and they looked at it and they're like, wait, 80% of our score metrics? Oh, we got to change this. And so it was what we're seeing, they're out in the backyard, they start up with some drinks, and they said, you got to change this. What are some ways we can brainstorm and change the process? And what they did, they shifted, you can see here that there's attributes and metrics before this 2% attributes. They added a perspective and a mission score to action, so the attribute section. So in other words, what perspective do they bring that other applicants may not have? Generally, those from underserved backgrounds, what perspective can these applicants bring? The other thing that they brought in was the mission score. And we can talk about mission. Does this applicant, does it relate to the mission to a department? They didn't have that before. And by getting there, they were able to see the breakdown. So they went to experience with 22% of the score, attributes went to 36%, and metrics went down to 42%. And then what they saw after 1 year of implementing this was they did get more unrepresented medicine applicants invited to interview. That were interviewed, they didn't talk about increase in diversity of residency program, but they did show that, hey, up at the top of score, they were very consistent. So what that basically is saying, we put a rank A, what are the scores that will help start the ranking process? And they noticed that those who are underrepresented in medicine had a higher score. Actually, not only higher scores, but underrepresented in medicine applicants had a higher rate of increase, or larger increase than those who were non-represented.
Just curious, let's see to correlate to who's achieving. Or just in the evaluation.
Yeah, this was helpful to get a larger pool of diverse interviewees and to get them higher up and potentially go into the randomness. But it's not line up ourselves in these applications. So the point of this is, what if people look at these pictures? What are some studies that relate to this? This is a landmark study. It's a little older than not medicine, but it is a cool, real development of studies. But it is basically symphony. So it's in symphony auditions. What if we blinded them? So all you did was hear the musicians. Before, that was man. And it would happen by a conductor to pick, kind of handpick some of these people. Oh, I want you to do the symphony, or I want you to do the top five symphonies. Predominantly male. Then in the 70s and 80s, they could be blind. So the point is, like, you know, you can hear their point, walking across the baby, or kind of smoother there. And it balanced the gender as well by having blind auditions. So that was one cool, interesting study. But what about in terms of medicine? I think this is also another cool study because it's both methodology and color perception study. They took sham applications, and they have they pulled readouts from five different institutions that said, hey, you pay a few uses in the campus, let's take a look at these applications, and you should be. They just took stock pictures, they had some, and they made up some applications, and they had great coverage. What they did was that there were predetermined levels of attractiveness and obesity. So what you see here is that 85% out of line. If the bars don't reach over, you're probably not getting an interview at one of these five institutions. You can see that the more attractive you are, whether you're obese or not obese, you're more likely to get an interview. And the less attractive you are, if you're not, whether you are obese, you're less likely to get an interview. There's another study that came out too that I don't have on here, but it's the dermatology. They looked at associated pictures and at UNC pictures, and then whether they would get really matching from each other or not. So that was actually UNC, but anywhere in dermatology. And there was associations of like women, whether they were longer or shorter hair, whether they were glasses, whether they were smiling or not. Yeah, so you can see how this is there's at least one commentary to dermatologists. All this is saying, hey, what have we blinded ourselves to the pictures? No great study on what could happen for that. I think it's going to be a little hard to fully blind someone to the bias, but something to consider. I know that the vendor may start to do that, so that was part of their, didn't mention that before, but part of their process is they have to get rid of the pictures as part of their application. Oh, this is an interesting concept, which we all know just through experience, is you see someone's gateway, you see someone who's got all of it, you see someone who did the amazing steps forward. And then everything after that, it's like, you can get better than that. Okay? Or you see a poor level of reference. They didn't do well at that in a workshop. And then everything else, it shows up in studies. So there's correlations, and there's correlation between the different steps. So even though it's the same people that's interview, we have experiences, actions, and metrics, you have to be worried about feeling more effect because those domains can be correlated together. How do we divorce them? How do we become more independent? One strategy is to do what's called correlation is high. hired them. And that's the point is, it'd be great to be able to have these different degrees independent. The issue is how you adapt that holistically. Because if you just look at personal things, you just look at a list of items on a CD, but you don't understand the rest of their file, you've got to be a little careful. So I don't think we're necessarily here. It's something to consider. We've got to figure out how to adapt, how to core out the view with those community. We'll be talking a little bit about this, and what's cool about that we are slow, and the reason that there seems to be some data that there is less gender bias with slow recruitment. At least, even in the report that there's a couple people also with the osteopathic presence program to see that there's less gender bias. However, there was an abstract that was presented just at court that we not get the racial bias, and that you know, like the anchors, the different names in the SCO, there it seems to represent minorities in general score lower than those who are not represented. So something to keep an eye out. What do you do with all this information? I think the point is, hey, there's bias, and I gotta take things as a whole. I gotta look for companies as a whole. So if I see something that's not a great recommendations, what happens is they are also in that these are patternable or not. So those kind of trends. Less MLA. I feel like I'm speaking to the choir here, but I think it is important to talk to your colleagues about this, that this step, the US MLA steps were designed for one thing. If you were to be step one, step two, and step three, that you can practice medicine. That's what it was designed for. It wasn't designed to say how great you're going to be at residency. And there's even studies within emergency medicine and outside of emergency medicine that do not show correlation between step one score and how well you do residency. In fact, there was there's not a control for you, one study I really like that came up in a different area of development programs at the West Coast. It asked for residency program directors to grant rate their graduates grant voter list. The top graduate, the second top, the third top, and then there was no focus on step one score. The other one to the lower left, that's a great article to read as well too. It just kind of shows that again step scores are not really correlate with success in the medicine. In fact, it decreases diversity. We've seen already the list of views on the example of holistic review. Papers from Austin, from Denver, how the gene assessment scores have actually increased the diversity of applicant pool, interview pool. But it's not only in emergency medicine, it's in other specialties as well. There's a pretty big study that kind of came out on internal medicine residency and how step one scores increase diversity in their
applicant.
There's not as much data on step two. That's a great point.
We have to do the pass and fail.
Step one pass and fail, but not step two. And that's going to be a game changer. That's going to be something to work out for is how people are going to reach out to step two scores. The step scores do seem to be associated with the risk over when you pass the certified data that's certified. There's that association. It might be a one pass somewhere. But again, if you trade out of that, it's a person who's going to be again, what it also kind of points out to you, we're talking about our training and our preference.
Oh, wow.
That's
my brother.
Great. Okay. So the study that I want to give you for this, I think, out of UCSF, is running a call. And it showed that at UCSF, when you make clerkships, you get created, you get there's different domains, like history taking, or physical exam, synthesis of information. There was no difference between those who were unrepresented medicine and those who were not unrepresented medicine. However, when it came to final grades, there was a difference. Unrepresented minorities were less likely to get honors, even though there was no difference between the individual scores, individual domains. So there, you can see that there's some bias. That comes into first grades. another pitch for being the narrator. You have to look for attributes and for competencies with the attributes there. I put this out there because I think it does help them. When we look at applications, understanding how honors or whatever grades are for what percentage, I think that can help. How much of the exam counts towards the final exam, the final grade of the question. See, this is where I think you can get the fun, this is where you get things, everything from experiences, even the attributes are also there. This is where you can go back to the mission department and that you find out what relates to what you want to see. So for instance, for us, President of SMA is huge for us. President of MSA is really huge for us. The partnership because of not only leadership and service, but also because it shows the commitment to partnership, especially with other companies. Not all of them, but other companies. So you can take that. The personal statement. I know it's hard to read all of these. This is where I've been reading more and more personal statements, especially when I want to figure out the distance traveled for our applicants. Media talks about the capability of learning medical school, getting into medical school. Media talks about their grade. Media will talk about their values. Do their values align with what our values are? I like to look for personal statements that are more other-oriented as opposed to self-oriented. Service-oriented versus not. So those are something we look for in mission statements. So one thing I would like to ask is to re-examine the homework after the research, to re-examine how you do your review. Can you make it more holistic? You can just practice in a regular process or not re-examine how we put the things and how we can kind of meet our holistic review. Another thing I think is helpful is that I am advised that every single year we look at how the demographics are seeing the world has changed. And that can kind of help us with the second number of these goals. The last thing before I end is talking about cultural change. And while I can be up here talking about all the stuff that I've done and show off that I am, there was a lot of tears, there was a lot of uncomfortability, uncomfortable instances that we have. We had our chair stop this building, say, after rank day. Everyone in my office was talking about this. I'm here. How did you get this person to jump up? Fill these classes on someone else. You had a perfect application. We had a lot of psychologists, VAs, discussion within our programs based upon how rank day went. And I'm comfortable with the folks. So, big part of this, and I feel so much better now, is that even though the fact that it did feel